It's been 20 years. I have been talking about Siridhanya. And I'm the happiest man right now on this planet. The simple reason is that coming next 20 years, the whole human race is going to eat Siridhanya. There is no way out for the human race. It is to my luck that I have been the chosen one to say Siridhanya is the food of human race. It should have been, but it was not. That's okay. Now onwards, it will be. And this is the beginning of that era where the whole human race is going to embrace these, if not these five grains, some more will be added by future generations, depending upon the locality and area. But these five grains are universal. They are regional, they are local, they are national, they are international, and they are universal food. There is no doubt about that. And the reason why they will become universal food is that the consumption of these five grains can and will bring health into the human body. There is no doubt about this. In the last 10-15 years, we have seen lot of patients that are just about to die have regained their health, be it cancer, be it HIV, be it SLE, be it multiple sclerosis. This kind of very difficult and complicated cases have been slowly and steadily gaining health into their bodies. It all can happen only through Siridhanya, and medicines are peripheral. And already you have all noticed my saying. It's not exactly my saying, but then I have proved that it is so. That if your food is right, there is no need of medicine. And if your food is not right, no medicine will work. And this is the statement that the human race has to live on. Absolutely, this should be our guiding principle. And in that context, I believe I am the first person to do some fundamental work and defining the word food for the human gut. And that definition is release of glucose into the blood slowly and steadily on regulated conditions. And that capacity is given by God to these wonderful five grains. And there will be many more, I am sure, the human race is going to discover. And now, I am so convinced, so thoroughly convinced that these five grains can restore health into the lost human wavering minds. And presently, we have seen some wonderful results even in the patients that are disturbed mentally. So, it is not just the physical health that this Siridhanya can provide for the human race, but even the mental and emotional delving, all these concepts are going to slowly come into the realm of Siridhanya. And it is so satisfying for me in the last 2-3 years, because we have seen this quantum leap of the acceptance of Siridhanya as food in the last 2-3 years. And it is reaching beyond the boundaries. So, Siridhanya is going to go beyond the boundaries, and I have been contacted from various countries. Various people have been inquiring about the availability, and we have been trying to tell them that we will give you the seeds and you should grow in your place and start eating. Because right now only Karnataka, Tamil Nadu and a few places in Andhra and Telangana are growing this in large scale, and it's a matter of few years that the whole world will catch up on this. And I said I am very happy, I am the happiest man, because I can envision a world where there will be no hospitals. No hospitals, I mean no hospitals the way they are now. We do need hospitals, we do need doctors. There are emergencies, there are certain things beyond human capacities. Such times we do need this kind of emergency ICUs, all that. But the way the hospitals right now functioning and the culture of the hospitals is absolutely not the one that a civilized society requires. A hospital should have been a different place than what it is now in the present civilized world, be it in America, be it in Australia, be it in India, be anywhere else. So the philosophical approach of a hospital should completely change, and that's going to happen. All these things are slowly getting very clearly envisioned in my mind. And we are looking into that kind of future where things are going to be gentle, kinder, and socially satiable. So when you eat Siridhanya, your satiability is reached not after a long time, in a short period of time. But that the satiability lasts longer. So when you eat in the morning your Siridhanya food, you are not hungry for food anymore. You don't go on looking for something to eat. You don't think about food. And that is the definition of food. The same way we define a doctor. When a doctor sees a patient and he interacts with him, after a few hours or few days, there should not be any need for a doctor for the patient anymore. So once the doctor interacts with the patient, the secret of health should be handed over to the patient. And that is the definition of doctor. The same way, when you take food, you should not think about food for a long time. And that is the definition of food. And that way also, the definition is met by only Siridhanya. And that's why we actually titled today's topic, Siridhanya Beyond Health. The reason why we were talking about Siridhanya on health grounds is because we are all sick now. There are so many sick people in the society. As I have been mentioning in my earlier lectures, that 30 out of 100 are BP patients, 30 out of 100 are diabetic patients, 30 out of 100 are thyroid patients, 30 out of 100 are constipated patients, 30 out of 100 are rheumatic patients, 30 out of... So now all things can be 30 now. Earlier we used to say 15% of cancer patients, now it is also caught up. So when we add up all these things, it's going beyond 200. That means it is not that one person has one sickness. Each fellow has got two or three sicknesses. And that is the sad story of human race in the present day. And it's all going to change. It's all going to change in the next coming 5 years. That I am 100% sure. And how do we change it? And this is the staple food. This is the center. This is the fulcrum. And around it, we have oils, we have cleaning system, and we have the sweet world. So we have got all these areas identified which are to be healthy. Healthy oils are the oils that you make out of the oily substances by the least processing. They are called Ghana oils. We have already started this in many places. The earlier days we used to use the bulls which keep going round and round, called Ghana, and we press them in the normal temperature and pressure. And that's what exactly is actually cold pressed. Means there is no temperature, there is no pressure. At the room temperature and the standard STP, they are called STP. So that kind of oil is essential for the growth of human babies. Very important, because the parts within our body, some of them are made by fats. And the fats that are building our internal organs have to be pure. And that basic responsibility to supply the pure oils is again to be taken care of locally, not transporting in the centralized fashion. And that is the problem with the present world. The oils are contaminated, adulterated, and there is not actually got the real oil. Most of it is synthetic oils derived from refinery industries. So beyond Siridhanya, this is one of the most important factors that can create unhealthy conditions, and we have found the most satisfying product in this Ghana oils. So just if the whole villages start making these oils, the economics of this oil industry will shift from the centralized refined oil industry to the decentralized villages. So that is possible only when we start looking into this kind of aspects. So it is not now just the health of the people, it is the health of the villages, the economics of the villages coming into picture. And we have released the bottleneck of machinery for the Siridhanya to be prepared into rice by simple mixy method, which we called Bucci method. That means we don't need to take the grown Siridhanya into a centralized machinery mills and then start distributing it to the final product into the people. Each and every village that grows Siridhanya can make Siri rice, Siri akki in their own village, first consume themselves, and the remaining they can start pushing it into the nearby towns, then if excess is then nearby cities. Beyond that, it doesn't need to travel. So the transportation of the finished product is going to come down enormously from the centralized machinery that is working now. Though the rice, even the paddy rice, is grown in various parts, everything is centralized into big machines and then the distribution starts. So this unnecessary transportation of centralizing things and again distributing is absolutely an environmental negative carbon footprinting. So this is to be removed. We need to process the Siridhanya there and then locally and then consume, and the remaining to be transported into the different places where it is necessary. So the whole transportation processes are completely not necessary if we visualize a decentralized processing units, a small and steady units which requires human labor. So we have got some designs of these kinds of ghataka, we call them. They are already functioning, if not many right now, in few in number, but they are functioning well. So we can actually think of lot of economic activity in the villages for the women and the men. So it is this kind of vision that is going to drive the centralized process to a decentralized processes, where the Siridhanya concept is going to drive the economics of the smaller and smaller and smaller places. So we have identified five areas. One is toothpaste. Now all the people in the world are using toothpaste to brush the plastic, which is the most deadly for both the people who are using it and for the environment. In fact, it is calculated just the toothbrush alone has killed 6% of toothbrushes alone. The left out toothbrushes have killed 6% of biodiversity on this planet. 6% of biodiversity, and the damage is extended to even to the coral reefs. The brushes that we are throwing somehow are finding their way into the coral reefs in the deep oceans. So it is high time we all switch to the consuming culture, to the conserving culture. And that conserving culture is to use the natural toothbrushes that are available and made, should be made available by yourself in the form of neem tree, in the form of pongamia tree, in the form of jackfruit tree, in this particular locality. If you go to north, there is called Meswak tree and there is Amrutphal tree, that is Sibe. So various kinds of sticks from the natural resources there and then. That means we visualize, even if you are living in an apartment complex, you could make your own toothbrushes by what is called roof gardening. Roof gardening. So an apartment complex would have a roof garden area wherein you will have these materials available for all of you. You don't need to buy these toothbrushes and toothpaste that are synthesized in central way and then pushing it into your mouths. And the best option we have to clean our teeth is charcoal powder, activated charcoal powder, which is the healthiest thing that is found on this planet. And that you can make in your own houses. If not in your houses, small scale industries can thrive in the villages and then supply to the local towns and cities. So this is the another most important area where the dental problems can actually transcribe into very serious ill health conditions in the human body. Just day before yesterday, I got a patient who had come to me 3 months back. 32-year-old man had a pain in the tooth. Then he went to the dental doctor. They said your root canal has to be done, and something they did for a few sittings. And then all at a sudden his jaw stopped moving. He couldn't move the jaw. It just got stuck. It may be one in crore case. What do you do? Then they put a tube. Actually, they didn't come to my clinic. This happened in Andhra. Someone contacted me and told me this case. Then I told them, please feed Ganji of Navane, foxtail millet and brown top millet. After 8 weeks, that boy started moving his jaw. So day before yesterday, 2 days back, he called me. Now he is able to eat properly. It's been 3 months that he is doing that. And Ganji, I told you in one of my lectures that if you cook in the morning, soak the millet, all these 5 grains, any one of the millets, night, and cook, especially in a clay pot, 15-20 minutes, well-soaked millet can be cooked very easily within 5 to 10 minutes. Make ganji and keep it. Tie a cotton cloth on top of the mud pot. Keep it till the evening and then consume that ganji. The healing effects of that ganji are 10 times better than just making cooking ganji and then eating. So that boy followed for more than 3 months this kind of food and he was able to get back his lost nervous connections. What I am trying to communicate is natural diseases can be easily cured. Even this kind of unnatural diseases like this were set right by this wonderful Siridhanya because they have all kinds of vitamins, minerals and a lot of other parameters that we are not even aware of. Especially, many people are not aware of, they have got what are called lignans. The upper layers of this fiber has got lignans. They are very fantastic part of the nature. In fact, lignans are the intermediate chemicals that make the plant grow into wood. It keeps accumulating wood in large quantities. That lignin it is called. So, making wood on the plants is called lignification. These lignins are very stable polymers. And so the intermediates of lignans, that lignans are present in many of the plant materials. And they are wonderful stabilized structures which can start cleaning your body very thoroughly. And that is the beauty of Siridhanya. This content of lignan is present in these grains. That's what makes them very beautiful for health and healing purposes. It is not just the fiber content. It is the exact structures of these lignans, varying structures in these 5 grains, gives them the wonderful healing capacity of various organs in our body. And all these things have to be researched much more into the future. Generations are going to do this. I am only trying to initiate the steps that would be helpful for the future generations because no one has taken these aspects of study in the present day scientific world because all the scientific world is looking into making money. The Western thought process in the biological world are all looking into something that can be patented, that can be made into a medicine, that can be made into something, products. So the research itself has actually lost way because of this commercial entity coming into the picture. So we need to shake all these bad aspects of pursuing the science in its true sense. And I think it is high time the human race recognized this aspect, that we need to work for the well-being of life forms on this planet rather than economic growth of few companies or few countries. This is the most important point that we all should recognize, and especially the scientific world in quotes has to recognize. We have failed in this aspect, that we need to remove the economic content from this wonderful world of life-saving researches. And it has to be straight, simple, and giving. Nothing more than that. In that context, I believe the world of Kashava, the world of Siridhanya, the world of Ghana oils, the world of activated charcoal for the cleaning of the mouth, and then the local plant materials to further clean up your mouth in the morning. So basically you need to take the charcoal powder and then with your own finger keep brushing. See, the word brushing has become, even this is we are calling brushing, it's not brushing. We have to massage our gums and then clean the teeth. So the massaging of the gums is not being done with the brush. And when you massage the gums in the morning, the blood circulation starts. And the charcoal, the activated charcoal, removes the dead bacteria and even live bacteria which are not necessary, which are harmful. Even the required ones will be built day in and day out. So the early morning when we clean, and then people have been told that your enamel will get damaged if you use the charcoal. This is how the toothpaste came into our, and it is a funny statement because enamel is the hardest substance in the human body. So the activated charcoal is so soft it cannot do anything to that. And this is the lie that the scientific world has told and made all the changes. And the whole world is using now the brush and paste. It's the most unscientific thing to do. These are the few simple things that we all have to think and get back to the natural means. And many people are informed that you will have black patches when you use this black charcoal powder. But it is not the case. And even if it is there sometimes, in fact it is not the charcoal that is going to appear, it is the plaque. That uncleaned stuff that is getting deposited near the gums and the edges of the teeth, that can be effectively cleared in a matter of 2 to 3 days if you use these wonderful organic materials, neem, pongamia, or tamarind, or jackfruit. These juices have got wonderful liquids that can remove all this in a matter of 2 days. So if you use for 5 days this tooth powder that we have been talking about, charcoal, activated charcoal, and once a week or twice a week one of these sticks of neem tree or pongamia tree, in north they have different kinds of trees that can supply this kind of small sticks, and then you brush, you can make a brush, real natural brush with those sticks, and then remove it, and the liquid that is generated through these sticks itself can clean all the plaque very easily and wonderful. So the whole idea why am I spending so much time on this is that we need to find natural means. Whatever goes into our body, it has to be natural. Only then we can be healthy. So we need to get out of this artificial, chemical and chemical generated products. The future generations of human race has to depend on these natural processes. And in that condition only we have got what is called Kashava. And I really appreciate and recommend highly Siripaka, where they have made Kashava as one of the important aspect of their food. And coffee, tea, I have explained to you many times, not even one assemble of this coffee business is good for you. Not even one. No sugar is no good for you, milk is no good for you, caffeine is no good for you, and drinking hot coffee is absolutely bad for you. So we have somehow embarked upon this coffee tea idea, and the whole world is drinking coffee tea. So this is a sad story of human race. We need to get back to this wonderful kashaya world of various kashayas. We have identified almost 20 to 40 kashayas. Our area, South India. If you go to North India, we can identify another 30-40. If I go to America, we can identify another 30-40 there. So it is not necessary that we have to transport these kashaya leaves to America. In America, pine trees are seen everywhere. So you can have pine leaves, pine caddies as the toothbrush, and pine nuts, that milk for kids. We are telling that people should have their milk weaning time. The kids weaning away from their mother's milk should be embarking upon coconut milk, sesame milk, ragi milk, like that in our areas. In North America, they can get into pine milk and some other nuts that they are getting. They can make milk out of that and give to their kids. So they may not grow ragi there. So they don't need to give ragi milk. They don't grow coconuts there. So they don't need to give coconut milk. So in each and every locality and the regional, there will be some materials that can give milk, that can give this kind of cleaning brushes. All kinds of things are available in each and every part of the globe. So we need to look and research in this fashion to expand the horizons of people's health, merging into the natural substances. And it has to become local and decentralized. So a neem stick is good for here, and a meswak stick is good for north. And if you go to Tibet, it may be something else. If you go to China, it may be a bamboo, I don't know. We need to go there and figure out. Like this, the rules of the game is to look for local materials for our day-to-day consumption, and that becomes a conserving culture rather than consuming culture. So if I want to use daily a neem tree, I will make sure that there are neem trees all the time. If I am using toothpaste, I don't find any necessity, so I cut the tree. This is the problem that has happened all over the world. So we need to get back into this mode of respecting nature. And how do you respect nature? Only when we are interacting with that. Amrutabali kashayam I drink daily, then I will grow amrutabali on my rooftop. Tulasi kashayam I drink once a week, then I will grow tulasi. Ruta, gravulens, sadapaku, nagadali for brain tumor. So if I have any problem with my brain, I need to go and drink. So if I don't want to have any problems with my brain, I need to drink this kashayam once in a while. See, now we have got from this mode of becoming healthy to staying healthy and being healthy. So it is not just health for the lost people. Who have lost health, who are gaining health. But then to be healthy is our main motto for future generations. So we are not going to be sick anymore. Why we are not going to be sick anymore? We are going to practice the natural, local, available materials. We are going to be completely submitting ourselves to the local materials and be part of the nature. So we are not going to destroy the environment that we live in. We are going to enhance because we need that. So we are becoming part of nature rather than nature being our servant. So you see the shift from consuming culture to conserving culture. That's exactly the motto of Siridhanya. Siridhanya doesn't consume any natural resource. It requires just 4 rains and then wonderful food is ready for us. And all the other food materials that we are consuming presently is consuming the nature itself. And that is the result. We are not going to have water in future. There is no water. In next 10 years, there will be no water to even drink. Then where are you going to produce these huge amounts of rice and wheat and eggs and chicken and meat, which requires, a kilo requires 50,000 liters of water. A kilo of sugar requires 28,000 liters of water. So just translate that into Siridhanya. If, say, approximately 30,000 liters you require to produce 1 kilo sugar, you require 300 liters. What does that indicate? We can produce 30,000 divided by 300. 100 kilos of Siridhanya. Just imagine, 1 kilo of sugar can give you 100 kilos of Siridhanya. And each kilo of Siridhanya, if you soak well and cook, can be consumed by 10 people. That means the water parameter alone tells you how bad we are at environmental economics. So if you can produce 1 kilo of sugar, 100 people will drink 100 coffees, finished. And you get sick. That's a separate issue. And now we have, out of that 1 kilo sugar, we can make 100 kilos of Siridhanya, and 100 kilos can be consumed by 1,000 people. That means 1 kilo sugar, we have used that much water, which is equal to 1,000 people's healthy food. See the equation? How drastic it is? And then 1 kilo sugar has created at least 1 diabetic patient. Am I right? And we are producing, India alone is producing right now per year 48 lakh tons of sugar. Can you believe the amount of water that we are consuming? And you see why there is not going to be any water? In fact, we have dried up the rivers. We have dried up the underground water. And if you now think of meat, each kilo meat has 50,000 liters water. So approximately you are talking of 160 kilos of Siridhanya with reference to 1 kilo meat. And you see the number of means that you can produce like this. So this is beyond health. Siridhanya, apart from giving you health, what is it going to solve for us, for the human race in the future? The water crisis. And if there is anything in this world that can save the human race from the water crisis, it is Siridhanya and Siridhanya alone, nothing else. Nothing else can save the human race out of water crisis. So if Siridhanya is our main staple food, all this huge, humongous amount of water is released for the rivers to flow back, for the coffee estates, for the tea estates, for the sugar estates, completely disappearing. Just visualize all the forests coming back. So now, when you look this way, that there is no coffee, there is no tea, there is no sugar, how much water we are saving. So what is the alternative? We have already figured out all the alternatives. Gongura is our alternative. Tulasi is our alternative. Neem leaves are our alternative. Tinospora is our alternative. Ruta is our alternative. Everything that just can grow by itself, with the water that you can wash your legs, can make you all these wonderful kashayas. This is what is called decentralizing. And this is what is called consuming. This is what is called conserving. So Siridhanya is slowly paving way for the human race to embrace a conserving culture and leaving this consuming culture. And that's why I titled this talk Siridhanya Beyond Health. Health is given. No discussions now. Say if I were to say 10, 15 years back, Siridhanya given, health, no one would have accepted. But then we have traveled enough. Enough number of people on this planet now have gained health. It may not be 70%, but enough number for me to talk confidently that if human race embraces Siridhanya as staple food, I am 100% sure once in 6 months we can start closing down the hospitals step by step. And then if we embrace the kashaya, another 25% of the hospitals will start closing down. And I have also clearly established 7 kashayas for us to keep away from all these viral diseases that can hit us without warning, like H5N1, Zika, Nipah, all these kinds of instant diseases. I call them instant diseases. Sankramika Rogagalu. It can spread in no time. Infectious diseases. So only this conserving culture can provide a wonderful sheath for the human race not to be affected by these infectious diseases. And the 7 kashayas, again I will tell you, Garika, that is called Bermuda grass in English. Tulasi, Osimum. Amrutabali, Tinospora. Bilwa, Egale. Honge, Pongamia. Devu, Ajadarikta. People. Ravya, Arali, Ficus religiosa. These 7 in the same order, you take once a week, that is Bermuda grass kashaya for a week, Osimum for a week, Tinospora, Amrutabali for a week, Egale, Bilwa for a week, Pongamia for a week, Ajadarikta, Bevu for a week, Neem, People, Arali, Ficus religiosa for a week, continuously in the same order, you will have no fear of any of these infectious diseases. Period. Simple, straightforward. Starting from 1-year-old to, if 108-year-old, old man can also get the benefit. Very simple, very easy, no one need to buy anything. Everything is available in our local areas. Even apartments in big cities like this can have their roof gardens decked up with this. And in fact, Sridhar Murthy promised me that he would bring all these plants and display in his restaurant next 10 to 15 days. So people can see the plants themselves and then maybe have a small nursery, you can take them back and start growing in your houses. They will grow anywhere, no problem. You just have to pour water that you are going to throw in your kitchen, put it there in that pan. This is what is called conserving culture. And if you all stop coffee, tea, shift to Kashaya's culture, see the wonderful benefits for your body, for your environment. And this is beyond health. This is beyond health. And this is the point I wanted to drive home, because many of my lectures I keep rambling for this, and then the whole group of people say, I have this disease, I have this disease, I have this disease. And then I keep telling this, and the time gets over. We wanted just a half an hour to 1 hour time for the people to recognize the immense benefits that the human race has in store if human race embraces this conserving culture. It's not just Indians. It's not just Americans. It's not just New Zealanders. Anyone, any human conglomeration can start practicing these principles. Then the whole planet will be a better place to live for the future generations. Are you with me? Are you with me in this?
Yes.
Just close your eyes and think of these situations. And it gives me immense satisfaction and pleasure that we can dream of these things in a time where there is so much sickness around us. We have found a way. We have found a path. We have found simple methods to transit from this complicated, complex, unlivable conditions to a livable, wonderful, healthy and greening. Real greening of the planet can happen only when we change our food. Many environmental groups, many intellectuals are saying, we have to green the planet, we have to green the planet, because we have been cutting the trees. But that's not the right way to look at it. Okay, we green the planet. Imagine all of the human race stops doing everything from tomorrow and greens the planet. We'll keep growing trees everywhere, nothing else we do. In 10 years we'll grow all the trees. But then it will not take more than 30 years for us to be in the same condition. If we don't change rice, wheat, sugar, coffee, tea, meat and eggs. You understand this point? So the real greening of the planet happens when you change the food, that food material that we are eating. And this connection is very important for everyone to understand. So you cannot say, I have planted 100 trees and then come back home and eat omelette, burger, McDonald's, drink Pepsi, drink coffee day coffee. Nothing is going to change. And that is the problem with the present day consuming culture. So you may plant 100 or 1,000 or even 10,000 or 1 lakh trees, but they are all going to be cut by you only. If not now, in another 10. Because we had just 50 years ago many more trees than all of us can do in the next 10 years. We had wonderful forests just 50 years ago. We had more trees than ever you can imagine, ever even you can imagine to build or grow. Why are we now in this state? It is because the way we ate our food in the last 50 years. As simple as this. And I want to drive this point home into this small gathering so that you can help me to drive this point into others' heads. And this is the most difficult problem. So a lot of money is being spent. Oh, green this place, blah, 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 blah. But that's not going to solve our problem. People get angry when I say that. Because they are not seeing beyond that. We have destroyed forests. Not destroyed. If there is any better word. We have just decimated. Just 50 years. It took thousands of years for the nature to build them. We just decimated this forest in just last 50 years. Can you believe this damage that we have done? It's all because of the food culture that we have generated in the last 50 years. This has to change. And let the beginning be Karnataka, and that's what has happened, and it is happening. So 20 years back, I came back from America to see if I can start this. And I believe I am, if not completely successful, the first few steps of success are being built. Though it took 10 to 15 years for this concept to gain momentum in Karnataka, and as Sridhar put it, Andhra and Telangana people are taking it further, but they are taking it further with the confidence that Karnataka has given them. Imagine if I were to start in Andhra and Telangana, it would take the same 10-15 years. So, don't underestimate what Karnataka has done for this wonderful, healthy sojourn that human race has begun. So, it may look somber and Karnataka is doing slowly, but it has been the foundation. And what happens once you start building the walls? The foundation is not seen. And that's what it is, Karnataka. So people may say, oh, Karnataka, nothing is happening. No, everything has happened already. It has built the foundation. Now, the walls and the building and all the decorations will go on. So, I am ever thankful to the Karnataka because this is where the whole thing is built. Maybe we are not now running. We cannot run. We are now standing below the ground. And it will be so. And the foundation will become stronger and stronger as the building is built higher and higher. And this is what I wanted to communicate in short. We are looking at this kind of transformation. And the transcribing codes are built on tooth powder, on kashava, on siridhanya, on ghana oil, and on tati bellam. These five units are going to build the future human race health systems. These five: tooth powder, activated charcoal, Ghana oils, Siridhanya, what else at all? Kashaya, Tatibel. So if locally the villages can produce these five items, each and every village in a matter of year can earn how much money, do you know? If I calculate, just say toothpaste, 1,000 families a village per month, even if you say 200 grams toothpaste per month, 1,000 into each 200 grams toothpaste, how much is at present cost? 80 rupees. Okay, 100 rupees, just for calculations. 1,000 into 100 rupees per month. Per month, 1 lakh. 12 months, 12 lakhs. Just toothpaste. Now come to coffee, tea. 1,000 families. Coffee, tea powder, milk, sugar. Per month, each family, 2,000 rupees. So, 24 lakhs per year. Now, I'm actually calculating at the least. 12 lakhs plus 24 lakhs, 36 lakhs. Now, rice or wheat, per month, each family, 3,000 to 4,000 rupees, 3,000 we'll put. So, 72 lakhs. 24, 3,000, 36 lakhs. That is the least. 36 lakhs. So 36, 24 plus 12. Now, sugar. Tatibellam will come in. Now, oils. Each family per liter. Just say 1 liter per month. No. 2 liters. 3 liters. So, 300 per month, so 12 months, 3,600, approximately 4,000 rupees per family. So 4,000, 12 months, again, 36 plus 12, 48 lakhs. So 48, 36, 24, 12, 1 crore, 20 lakhs. A small village of 1,000 people can save in a year 1 crore 20 lakhs. This is the least. And then calculate the amount of money that goes into the hospitals. From 1,000. Now, the present day, each family in a village is spending minimum of 2,000 rupees to the doctors and pharmaceutical companies. Am I right? That's all going to stop. Another 24 lakhs. And then if you start calculating the carbon footprint from the transportation of all these things going up and down, that actually I have calculated, it comes to 48 lakhs. Just transportation of these materials. So we have reached 2 crores. So 2 crores per year, a small village of 1,000 people. Now, how many villages we have? 5,81,000 villages. And even if you think it is the least 1,000 people, what is the budget you are looking at? See, this all the money is lost by these villages nowadays. Now. So if we shift from this consuming culture to conserving culture, all that money is in the village. So, it's not just health, it is not just the environment. Whatever economies you want to bring in. Can they write these numbers? It's mind-boggling, am I right? So if we can all think of doing this transition, it is the economic model is going to be kaput in front of this ecological model. Am I right? That's why I keep telling this economic model is nothing when we embrace this ecological model. So, ecological model can include the economic model, but other way around is not going to happen at all, and we have proof now. Am I right? If all young boys and girls who have come here, if they understand this, I am the happiest man. Because all these old fellows are no use. Yeah, we are the fellows who did this. We are the fellows who transited from an ecological model to economic model. So, what can we do? We only can spoil it more and more. So I want the young generation to listen to this. I have not done exact numbers. This is just a sample of what is what and what is not. And all these so-called computer software engineers can sit and crunch their numbers and then present in Excel spreadsheets and PowerPoint presentations, and all that can be done. And I want that to be done, actually. Let this presentation, whatever you call, be the beginning of all this that can happen to the human race. And it will happen. And it should happen. There is no other model right now, till now. No human being on this planet has dreamt of this model till today. And I want to claim the credit for that. Happily, I also want to tell people, we have been able to, in the last 1 year, that I have been not talking in Kannada, speaking in Telugu, here and there, blurting out in English. We have had the good opportunity of finding solution to SLE, multiple sclerosis, some muscular dystrophy patients. Lot of healing effects have been registered in the last 2 years. So we are coming up with a table of food, kashayas, and what are the oils that is to be consumed. In another 10-15 days, we are going to release a PDF both in Kannada and English. That job is done in Telugu already. Telugu PDF is available on the net. We are going to add some more things and release the PDF for various diseases. And it is going to include for SLE, IBS. And of course, the first table for cancer is released in Kannada only, and inclusive of all these various conditions, we are going to bring out another booklet soon, in a matter of 10 to 15 days, both in English and Kannada. And I am also happy to announce that a small booklet in Tamil has also been released on PDF. Two books are there presently on Tamil, and we are also working on Bengali, Marathi, Hindi. All these languages are translating the books that we have provided for in Kannada and Telugu. It is going to happen in the next few months. And also, I am also happy, very happy to say that from various other parts of the globe, people have been inquiring, and many doctors, non-Indians also, have been looking into this food systems and the principles of getting better. So the word is spreading. And once we gather momentum, the world will change. The momentum That is the snowball effect we call. The snowball will be very small in the early stage. It may take long time, but then once it gathers the momentum, the transition will happen, it will just flip over. Has anybody watched a pumpkin grow? Has anybody watched a bottle gourd grow? No? It looks, the pumpkin is this much. And you keep watching daily. It will be that much, this much, this much, this much only. After 30, 40 days, it will be still this much only. After 2 days, you go and watch, it will be this big. We don't know how it happens, but it happens. And that is nature's beauty. And I think now all of you are feeling that you should grow a pumpkin and then watch how it grows. All right? In fact, it has been my dream. Though I have grown a lot of things, my grandmother used to tell me that the real pleasure of growing things, growing these plants, you will find only in growing pumpkin, she used to say. I never understood why she was telling that. Only recently, just enta, oka 6 nella inda, we happened to grow bottle gourd, sorakai. I had the blessing of God to watch this happen. I wish I had brought that sorakai. It is a very old variety, naughty tali, wonderful. I have it in my phone. I don't know where my phone is. I really want people to have this experience. It's amazing. It's amazing. You feel blessed when you see that happens, you know. Every day morning after working, I come and see that it is still this much, this much, this much. And the next day I go, it is this big. I wish I was sitting in front of it all the time. All the time I should sit in front of it. Next time, I want to grow, and I want to sit. When that stage comes, I have to forget everything and just watch that. Just watch that pumpkin grow. I mean, amazing. I cannot imagine how it happens. And these are the things that we have robbed from our experiences. It's just so wonderful to see that happen. And so these kinds of thrilling experiences we need to provide to our kids. Sadly, we ourselves have not. See, I have been doing this for the last 20 years, talking about nature, growing nature, this, that, and all that. So I used to always remember my grandmother. She used to be so happy when that pumpkin, you know, the pumpkin saru and foxtail millet rice, she used to cook. So tasty. I was a small boy. When I used to go from my native Prudhuturu to village where my grandmother used to be there. It's a small village. So I used to wait for the holidays just to eat that. And the other side, my father's side, there is another place, they used to grow Koda millet. Arka. There, she used to make brinjal curry with Koda millet. So these were the things that I used to wait for my holidays. The moment holidays come, I go there and that's how I spend. All the time the 10 months I am living in place thinking of pumpkin, saru and foxtail millet. That's how I grew up. And these are the beautiful feelings, experiences, and everyone should have this. That's what I feel now. Oh God, I wish I had more of such experience. Because it's always food. You ask your kids, even now they say, oh, masala dosa ali chenagirutte. Vidyarthi Bhavan Masala Dosa. We go for it. So the human race has not changed. It will be like this all the time, I am telling you. If you go back to Soligaru in Bear Hills, they will also tell the same thing. Oh, alli godaga alli halsinannu chenagirutte. They are not cooking, but they will go to that particular place only and then take halsinan. There are a lot of halsinannu trees. But those guys will remember only that because they have eaten everywhere and they didn't find that particular taste in that particular tree. So, human race has not changed. It will not change because this stupid thing from mouth to anus is the same. And we are robbing ourselves this wonderful, beautiful. This is mind-blowing. These experiences are beyond spirituality according to me. Moksha yarigbeko. This is the moksha. So once this is satisfied, then you think of moksha. Only then you think of moksha. So these are the things that we need to live for and we need to make our kids' life enlightened with this kind of wonderful experiences. And we are all missing that. And this hurry-burry life of cities is not only robbing these wonderful experiences, and a city like Bangalore is consuming everything. It's a devil. Consumes everything, including your life. You don't know you exist. Just to travel from this to place, it's only 5 kilometers. You take 2 hours. Earlier I used to travel 5 kilometers walking in 2 hours when a small boy. So, big deal being in a city. So you have all big cars, big roads, big things, but still you are not going to travel. So we need to decentralize ourselves both in thought and action. So directly and indirectly I am telling you guys, leave this place. Go back to villages. And that's where we have healthy societies. Of course, we need to transcend these difficulties. We need to dismantle these centralized processes, centralized living systems. We need to find ourselves being part of nature, not consuming nature. Thank you very much.